sad not to be in San Sebastian, enjoying this fantastic restaurants, these nice people, etc. So I learned Adolfo is in San Sebastian, so I'm also very jealous. I have to say I should have had the idea to come to San Sebastian. Okay, so, but also for all the people listening, so San Sebastian is such a nice place. And I think if they don't get in the school next year, I strongly recommend them to give them also a free voucher, because they should see San Sebastian. Okay, good. So I continue with my idea. You know, I buzzed you yesterday already about chirality. And I simply want to remind you, the world is full of chirality. So we already talked about molecules, and you heard nice lectures from Pablo about his chiral, his Moray lattices. And I mentioned also, if you go to smaller kind of, you see here, this looks like a piece of graphene. So you can maybe even twist it and see also interesting properties which are related to chirality. And there's a lot more studies on light matter interaction done in chemistry. So we might can learn also something here from this side. Okay, anyway, so in this part, I want to talk now about the semi-metals. I gave a brief introduction into topology last time, and we are all super excited about the semi-metal. And this is something which I explained yesterday, that semi-metals are quite common, or this linear dispersion in the band structure are quite common. If we would do the same as we did with quantum chemistry, looking simply for the whole band structure and thinking we can move the Fermi energy as much as we want, so what we can do in a certain approximation, then we would find everything is a Dirac and a Weyl semi-metal. So if it has more than one atom per unit cell. So therefore, there's still a lot to do. And especially in ferromagnets, I think, and I might not have the time to talk about magnetic Weyl semi-metals. In ferromagnets, in central symmetric ferromagnets, every crossing is a Weyl point. So because ferromagnet breaks time reversal symmetry, so I think there is still an inflation of nice materials to be found. Okay, so we also talked about how we come from molecules to bands, and that also here we can maybe learn a little bit from chemistry, because they can draw the band, or they learn also, I think also in physics you probably learn to draw in from a kind of linear combination of atomic orbitals to draw the bands by hand even. This is always useful. Okay, so we want to talk about the semi-metals, and which is a result of a band inversion. If we have certain points in the Brillouin zone which are protected by, for example, rotation symmetry, we can end up with these points. And if they are in high symmetry points, they are Dirac. But even if I apply a magnetic field to a Dirac point, what I usually do if I measure the Hall, so I split this Dirac point into two Weyl points, and then we have chirality. And here we have chirality of the electrons. So while we before had chirality of the molecules, we have here chirality of the electrons. And if you would think about what we talked about before in the inofficial time about this chiral molecules. So there's the idea that in chiral molecules like the DNA, if you have a transfer of, if electrons move through such chiral molecule, also spin and momentum is locked, very similar like in the topological surface state and topological insulators and in this Weyl semi-metal. The super exciting things is that the Weyl points have a phase. And so therefore this leads to very interesting properties, like that Weyl points behave like magnetic monopoles, and we have this very interesting Fermi arc on the surfaces of this Weyl semi-metals. And so the most exciting thing, I think, for me still is all the experiments related to the chiral anomaly. So this is a solution of the Dirac equation, which tells us that we can have a solution if we have this famous E dot B term. And I still think there's a lot more to think about E dot B, that you can have an anomalous non-conservation of a chiral current. So every violation of a parity is for sure exciting. And you can make this very nice analogy between high energy physics and the vacuum states and elementary particles and antiparticles with electrons and holes in a direct or bisimile metals. And so we can have the asymmetry here in a similar way. There's some discussion about that this might be the origin of the universe. So the asymmetry that we are having more particles and antiparticles. And as I probably mentioned yesterday, that these experiments are also of experiments in this direction are done with heavy ion collision. And they think in the next years they might have a breakthrough there. But we already can do this as informed from quasi-particle excitation. So we always deal with quasi-particle excitation in this Dirac semi-metals or white semi-metals. So I still have the slide. I thought I deleted it. So I think in general, it would be interesting whether we can, and this is a slide from Johannes, so whether we can do quasi-particle investigation, so in kind of quantum simulation, what people are thinking about in elementary particle science in high energy physics, or maybe even in astrophysics. So there's also super nice work from Maya, from Adolfo, and I think they are still thinking, and maybe they should make a summary or an overview article. So with the experiment I have to do, like 1, 2, 3, this would be helpful. Anyway, so and I told you also that in high energy physics, there's this parity violation, which was already discovered in 1956. And that if you have a beta decay of the cobalt atom, so they behave also like the right and the left hand. So so you see an asymmetry here, which is related to the subatomic weak force. And there was given even a Nobel Prize. And some people even think in this is not as a slide. Some people even think this can be an explanation why also for the origin of life. So why we are only made from one chirality of the DNA and not of the other, because if you take this weak force, this nuclear weak force into account, you see a difference in the energy of the different chiralities of the different enantiomers of organic molecules. So there's also somebody who dedicate more or less a scientific life to investigate this case. And we as simulators, so the nice thing is of topology, we can nicely make this analogies between all this high energy astrophysics things and the condensed matter, since we can simply look for quasi particles in the condensed matter system. So we use it as kind of quantum simulator. And to prove that something, some material is a white semi-metal, there's already this list 1, 2, 3, 4, as you can see here. And 4 is, means more. So we should look first for the Fermi arcs. I already said if you have this white points, you should have Fermi arcs at the surface. You should find this chiral anomaly, this additional B dot E term. So if the current and the magnetic field are in parallel, and you measure transport for white semi-metals, you would see very unusual properties, which you normally don't observe in other materials. And this can also happen if you add, instead of a voltage, a temperature gradient. This is the axial gravitational anomaly. And in general, you see very giant responses on external stimuli in white semi-metals. There's still a lot to explore, and people find giant Nernst effect, giant whatever effects, magnetoresistance effects, and so on. So this is old work of us and Binhai and others. So the simple white semi-metal systems, but it's good for the students to see an example. In reality, these crystals are very easy to grow, I would say. So you start with the powder, you put some iodine here, and this use is a kind of transport agent. So you have a temperature gradient here in your ampoule, and then you grow this very nice single crystals. Also, the structure is very simple, but then if you measure transport as a function of temperature here, for example, and in different fields, you see a strong change at low temperature, as function of the field in the resistance of this material. And you see these wiggles here. This is very typical for the semi-matter. They very often have fantastic quantum oscillation. So this is not, you could think this is simply some noise, but it's not. And then if you apply magnetic fields, the material later behaves more like a topological insulator. So it's not a semi-metal at all. In 9 Tesla, it looks like a semi-conductor. And the large magnetoresistance means also that the resistivity changes strongly as a function of this magnetic field. And you see by many orders of magnitude, and we know this is how we distinguish normally metals from insulators. But it's also interesting that all these white semi-metals or Dirac semi-metals shows this plateau at very high magnetic field. So I think there's still a lot of, I still think we not fully understand why it's semi-metal in the magnetic field. So because this is really for me always something amazing. And so in this niobium phosphide, you will see here's Y points. It's a calculation from Bin Hai. He looks still the same, I would say, not 10 years, but a few years ago. So, and you see in this compound, many of them, the Y points are slightly above the Fermi energy, but more or less in every wild semi-metal, we have the situation, there are very, very rare cases, like, or Dirac semi-metal, like graphene, and so that you only have the Y points close to the Fermi energy. Most of the time, this is simply a question of the band dispersion and the band structure. You have electron and hole pair packets. This is like the egg and the hen. This, they come together and it's very difficult to find a different situation. So here in this material class, we increase the spin orbit coupling and the relativistic effect by simply making the materials heavier. And this is reflected in the splitting here of the bands here. You see nicely here, the bands are nicely splitted, and also in the splitting of the Y points. The Y points are very close together, but the effects still in real space are quite large. I always think the interesting thing is we are always interested in Y points, which are very far away from each other, because in the electronic structures, this would mean that they are not so easily annihilated each other. But I always think, what are the consequences in? So this is reciprocal space. If you go to real space, it's everything goes one over. So the question is, maybe this is the explanation why we get this super giant Nernst effects in this material, which is most of the time at low temperature, but maybe if one can tune them to room temperature, it can really have impact to energy conversion. I think still this is a very unexplored area. And this is again, trying to motivate maybe people in thermoelectrics to think about the vials too. And then here you see the calculation from Bin Hai compared to the surface states. And here you see also nicely how the Fermi arcs become larger with the relativistic effect. But then the interesting thing for us was then to check the chiral anomaly and then the single crystal of niobium phosphide. We didn't find the chiral anomaly, but Johannes used focus ion beam to make this very anisotropic nice wires, because microwires, he likes nanowires. So, and this focus ion beam uses gallium to cut this very nice wires, and this gallium doped also the samples. And this was why what we then saw, even in this very nice quantum oscillations, that here in this focus ion beam FIPT samples, we really had the Fermi energy exactly there where we had the Y points. And this was the reason why you see this very nice chiral anomaly in this compound. And we don't have any current jetting here also, because the magnetoresistance effect in this small micro devices are smaller than in the single crystals. So you see what was predicted, the positive magnetoresistance if the magnetic field is perpendicular to the current. And if you turn the magnetic field in direction of the current, you see a nice negative magnetoresistance. And in this compound, the effect is even there and even stronger at 300 Kelvin. So this is amazing. So we have here even in this wires room temperature effect. Okay, then there was this very nice prediction also, and in this work also Adolfo is involved, so that if you apply a thermal gradient, you would see the axial gravitational anomalies. This was this paper here, hydrodynamic theory of thermoelectric transport in ricemia methods and Landsteiner gravitational anomaly and transport phenomena. And indeed, they saw exactly what was predicted, the B square behavior at a low magnetic field, and then the turn around into negative behavior. The prediction was it should go to zero field. So there are other also very nice ways to see the chiral anomaly, and one is also with optical detection. So if you investigate a chiral dependent photocurrent, so this tells us also nicely how we can work with circular polarized light. So this is also what is the experiment which Jen also predicted, to work with circular polarized light at a certain or with light matter interaction. And I still think there's a lot for us to do in this field. Anyways, this paper, and this Adolf Knoss brought also the paper into the even New York Times, which because the idea to use the condensed matter single crystals, nice single crystals for experiments which are predicted for astrophysics, is also exciting for the general public. And this is not a single case, so more or less here, this very nice work from Jos Herremans, who grows the best bismuth crystals, despite of Bob, I have to say, Kara. Okay, so he could show it also for bismuth, which was exactly doped to the Y points. So that this is a nice thing with that bismuth, if you put a little bit of antimony, it's or a little bit more of antimony, you exactly see the Y physics here in bismuth. Okay, so one
there is a question
from
Inigo Robredo. Can chiral materials with this kind of chiral responses be used to sort chiral molecules?
This is a very good question, but I don't want to answer this. I hope, but I should not tell you. Because this is a big, as I said, a big business also in industry, because nobody did it. It's not as simple as you maybe think, but maybe you have to first find these materials which do a very good catalytic activities. But I think there should be not a reason why not. Okay. Right. Anyway, so if we can do this, this would be super. Okay. And Inigo, you could help us by doing good calculation. Yeah, I'm sure he can help us. Anyway, so this tantalum, I think also this tantalum selenium iodide, which was in one of the papers as a predicted compound, showed this fantastic electronic structure. And I thought this is an ideal vial. Okay, so we made the single crystals immediately, but then we saw this is an insulator. So we were totally frustrated. But for me as a chemist, it was not so unusual, because you only have this degenerated points here. You don't have really a big Fermi surface. So if you lift this degeneration, you don't have to do too much to open a band gap here. And a system is always happier if there is a band gap. But so you have to slightly move the electrons. You have to put the electrons in this compound. And this is exactly what happens here. It's a charge density with instability. And what Johannes Butt saw immediately is also the chance that he might find an axion here. So he did this experience. The idea was, this was our hope, but the reality was this charge density wave. And so what he did, he wanted to slide the charge density wave. And what he did is exactly to prove the axion as the anomaly, chiral anomaly in this compound by first looking what happens if the magnetic field and the current are perpendicular and I apply voltage. So bias voltage on this material, nothing happens because it's the wrong direction. But in the moment when you have this E dot B term again, you can observe a negative magnetoresistance like in a ricemic metal. So he did this then also as a function of the angle, et cetera, very systematic investigation to show that this is really related to the axion insulator behavior. And this works exactly because which is more or less the not surprising, because while the charge density wave vector is exactly the distance between the two y points, this is quite tricky because the Fermi surface is not big, you know, to investigate here in real space. But we were lucky that we could show the super peaks, reflection peaks in the X-rays in this compound, which were corresponding to the distance between the y points. But there are more axion insulators in magnetic systems, and especially with this magnetic compound. And since eventually I can go up to some magnetic YSM metals, but eventually not. So I want to simply mention this compound, which is very famous now, the bismuth selenide, and its magnetic version. It's a 2D material. It shows a quantum unmanned soil effect at low temperature and many interesting properties, which were already, I think, discussed with the twisted graphene. But it also shows this axion behavior in this compound, depending here from also the applied voltage. So you can see a very nice, interesting topological phase and diagram here. So I come now to the recent project, which started more or less with this paper in 2006, already a long time ago, and many discussion with Jan, Barry, Maya, and so on, and Bob, and Andrew Bernovic. And so this was this prediction that if we have a 2 times degenerated point in the band structure or 4 times degenerated point, I could also invite and Dirac semi-metal, I could also have new versions of here, like 6-fold, something is wrong with the picture, sorry. This is all a little bit mixed up. Anyway, so, but it's maybe only for me. So you can find eventually higher degrees of degeneration in this new fermions. And there were predictions in the B20 structure where already people were interested, and I'm sure the skirmions eventually are even related to this interesting new fermions. But in this crystal structure, there are many, many more, not only magnetic ones, there are also non-magnetic ones. And more or less, there are recent publications on all of them, very hyper impact publication showing that you see this new fermions there. And this was at this time the prediction that you have this interesting chiral surface state. So you have chiral crystals and chiral surface state, but so what we have to know is also, and we learned that the band structure is not chiral, but there are also superconductors, and there are also chiral superconductors predicted in this paper. And I'm still fighting with my group that I get the single crystals, hopefully soon. Okay, so this also has drawn a lot of attention, especially also a nice commentary, which you can read here, so that you can maybe then even see more, much more beyond Y fermions and Dirac. So you could maybe even design materials. You can even see something where electron can morph into protons. This we don't see. If you would put a grid gitter on the universe. But I'm sure there's still maybe more to predict in this direction with where you have analogic experiments. But I think they already were able to do some experiments with muons and special muons and show that there is even it's possible that you can bring matter into antimatter, but I'm not so sure how valid this experiment is, since this is not our field of expertise. Okay, so coming back to chirality, not only the potatoes and the shoes are chiral, they have different chiralities. So if you want to read a nice article, you will find for sure something in Wikipedia. But also if our electrons in our electron spin and momentum is locked, they are chiral. So therefore, I think there must be much more interesting stuff to see. And the question is here really, can we have chiral molecules, chiral crystals, chiral electrons, and make chiral light to talk to each other? So this chiral crystals also combine in the sense it's obvious that you should do more on light matter interaction for the reason because chiral crystals are already, if they're insulating, are interesting because of their optical activities. Therefore, it's not so surprising that if you combine this with here the properties of topological crystals that you get prediction of very interesting optical effects. This is a good question. There's a question from Anna. Does chirality in superconductors have any effect in the direction of the flow of the upward course of vortices? Honestly, I don't know. Does somebody know, Adolfo? Anyway, we will keep this in mind, Anna. We will discuss it later, okay? I don't know, but maybe Adolfo has an answer. Do you have an answer, Adolfo?
I do not have an answer.
You will not have. But it's a very good question, Anna. I only have the feeling that if you have the chiral crystals, superconductors in a chiral crystal in this way, with these degenerated points, they are also non-chiral ones, the A15s, but they have these new fermions. I think we should, they have also, the question is, do we get unconventional superconductivity there? This would be my question, which I would ask, add to your question, okay? Anyway, so I have to move some things here because I think I don't see how to arrange everything to see everything. So while you have in a white semi-metal this Y points and the Fermi arcs, the nice and interesting thing is of this new fermion that we have now the points at different positions also, and this leads to this giant Fermi arcs. And here we put everything into color because we draw it in the chirality of the nodes, but it's interesting. So the band structure would exactly be the same, only the surface data chiral. They behave like right hand and left hand. And you have this giant Fermi arcs. And the other thing is also these points can be at different energy. And therefore, there are also this nice prediction like the quantized circular photogalvanic effect. So there, I still think that we can find more in the systems and we should investigate more of the different systems. Because some simple systems have quite simple band structure like cobalt silicide and rhodium silicide, some have a more complex band structure, what we see then in this quantum oscillation. So these crystals are made by more by other methods. So we grow them more out of the flux. So the best way to grow them is Kuchalski method, because then you can take a seed crystal with a certain chirality and you can then really grow one chirality. Okay, so if you have a tiny little crystal, so otherwise, out of the flux, what we normally do, it's a little bit more tricky with the optical floating zone. It's also not with the seed crystal, then it's also tricky to grow different chiralities. And it's really challenging to find a system where you can grow both chiralities. This was the case in palladium gallium, and this is therefore our most favorite system in some sense. So then you see here how it is, how the chirality of the different enantiomers looks like. This is a picture drawn in a special way to show you really the chirality. And here you see also how the enantiomers are distinguished in X-ray diffraction. So this is a big class of materials. So as I already mentioned, there are many materials in this class. And but what is really interesting is that the band structure is like the molecular orbital for chiral molecules. The band structure is totally identical. It's only the difference in the phase. And in this class here, the B20, here's this, for example, this I think is rhodium silicide, but I don't want to lie. Maybe it's palladium gallium because they all have more of the same electron count. So you have identical band structures, and we have here this fourfold Fermi ion on the at the gamma point and the sixfold at the air point. And you see here on the right side how these fermions look like compared to a Dirac-cone and how it looks like if we apply spin orbit coupling. So Niels has done a fantastic work here, for example, on platinum, aluminium. They all have similar band structure. He really showed nicely in Engelhardt photo emissions, the fourfold degeneration and the sixfold degeneration. And yes, so what I want to say is, I don't know, here's some mix up with my slide, but it doesn't matter. Okay, so but as I said, the band structure is the same, whether we take the right or the left-hand enantiomer, there's only a difference in the phase, and there's a difference in the surface state. And I think this is for itself already very interesting. And this is exactly what Niels then could show also. You don't can show the face if the band structure of both enantiomers looks exactly the same. But here you can nicely see that you have a difference in the nicely see. Okay, you need some fantasy, I agree. You see really this giant surface states, and they are having different chiralities. This can be nicely shown because we had two enantiomers here. And what is maybe more interesting, sorry, for the theoretician is that this six-fold fermion has a Chern number of +4, which was not seen before, and the four-fold also. And so the goal was really to show that you get this Chern number 4, and for this you had to, Niels had to measure both surface states, and because the spin orbit coupling is here also very large, you see even a splitting of the surface state, which MD has proven that this is surface state, because in photo emission you can show that there's no dispersion in the direction perpendicular to the surface state, and he could nicely show and also nicely show the splitting. So in this this way he could show that the Chern number is equal to 4. There was another prediction by Siri, Adolfo again, so which predicted the quantized circular photogalvanic effect, and Joe Ornstein tried to show this in rhodium silicide, which so far has a simple band structure. I'm sure Adolfo we will find nicer compound, because here is also not really a nice plateau. It looks quite lousy and it drops here again. So this is due to the other bands in this compound, but I'm quite optimistic that we still find better materials. So here's another work, also photo emission, this time from Hassan's group. So he also could nicely show in rhodium silicide and cobalt silicide that you find this giant Fermi arcs. I still think we maybe should do the photogalvanic effect in cobalt silicide. This is my intuition. Anyway, so then we did also some STM investigation. Sorry, still for the chaos on my slides. This normally looks not like this. Okay, so and here you already see, since this is a scattering experiment, you immediately see here even the difference of the different enantiomer already in the quasi-particle interference, where you have the scattering between the interaction more or less between the surface states and the bike electrons, which and shows again that the surface is the chirality of the surface state. Here you see quantum oscillation of one example part in gallium. You see they can be quite complex in this material, because we still have a few bands crossing at the Fermi energy, not only the R and the gamma point. And this is the reason why the quantum oscillation are very complex. And it's also the reason why we were not able to get really this nice plateau in the quantized circular photogalvanic effect. But the next point is, can we show, and this is for future work also, we started this, can we show that we have a really different phase in the band structure? And for this we did photo emission with circular photo circular polarized light, and we used two enantiomers. Again, here this is a theoretical prediction, so you should see really also here in the phase of the wave function for both chiralities, different colors here. This is the orbital angular momentum. And the idea is here to show, to compare it with the experiment. These are not published data from, again, Niels' group. And here you see also really that the enantiomers behave like hand and the two hands, left hand and right hand. While the electronic structure looks exactly the same here. The Fermi surface, the measured for both enantiomers, and this is the calculated. So you really can do this. It's a little bit tricky, the experiment, because if you use circular polarized light and not the right hand rule in a proper way, then you might imprint some chirality in the system, which gives you the wrong information. Okay, so going back now to Inigo's question. So can we use this chiral crystals for something useful? So first of all, what we do is we look whether we can use them for catalysis, and we tried already several. We have, I think, now like more than 10 papers on catalysis of topological material. Why do we think it makes sense? And this is really, if you look for the best catalyst for hydrogen evolution reactions, so simple things like water splitting, then platinum is the best. Okay, and since I'm also involved in spintronics, I also know that platinum has the highest Berry curvature, because in spintronics, people are interested in platinum for the spin Hall effect, because the spin Hall effect is also directly related to the Berry curvature. So here, and for oxygen evolution reaction, iridium dioxide is the best material. So this is also a known compound, which is topologically interesting. So platinum, for example, has here, this is a calculation of the surface state of platinum. And you see surface state are very close to the Fermi energy in platinum. And if you calculate the Berry curvature, this was already done by Nagosa a long time ago. You see also platinum is from the elements, the material which has a, from the non-magnetic elements, the material which has the highest Berry curvature at the Fermi energy. And iridium dioxide, you see, is a very nice nodaline material, so which we also know. So nodalines, not only crossing points, also nodalines around the Fermi energy lead to a large Berry curvature. So you can say it's accidental that the best catalyst for water splitting for both electrodes are topological material, but maybe there's also some rationale behind this. And in general, one can say that spin orbit coupling most of the time helps. So this also might explain why if you have a normal topological material like a Y-semi metal, you might, this we already shown, also have some catalytic activities. But here, what is the advantage if we have chiral materials, not only the crystalline chirality on top, we have also an interesting electronic structure, chirality in the electronic structure. But we also, since this degenerated points are at different energy, which, you know, this was a motivation for to think about the circular quantized circular photogalvanic effect. So because we have here different energy, we have also much wider range of energy which could be active for catalysis. So for this reason, we did the experiment here, water splitting, hydrogen evolution reaction with all the chiral crystals. We have to say the platinum containing chiral crystals are performing the best. And this is a so-called volcano plot, which the people like to draw. So they look for the current you use to split your water, and this is all in comparison with the best catalyst commercially. It's even a nanopowder on graph on carbon. So so far the best catalyst, but you see also that platinum gallium and platinum aluminium even are better than the best catalyst here. And if you see for different overpotentials, this is now only for the experts in chemistry, but I want to show you guys also and girls some impressive data. So this is a turnover frequency. So this scales how much hydrogen I get out of my experiment. And this is as a function of overpotential here, 0.1 volt, 0.1 and 0.2 volt. You see, this at 0.2 volt, it's even performs even more better than platinum carbon. So it's a good catalyst. Okay, so some of our publication also got some attention from other Nature Review Materials editors, and they wrote a nice article. And you see already in Nigo, she was thinking about something. Oh, this looks quite chiral. Even I think, I'm not so sure as a woman whether I love this picture, but anyway. So then also Jansson tried to connect a little bit more rational the berry phase with catalysis, and we tried several things here with the current. You saw it for the experiment even, and he could predict a few new catalysts using this, and we did some experiments proving that maybe this is a new descriptor and an interesting descriptor for predicting also new catalysts. Okay, so for the last minutes, I want to give a very brief visit to the magnetic white semi-metals. If there are any questions about the chirals, there people can ask. But just now, I don't see open questions. Okay. So as I said before already, why is platinum such a good catalyst? It's a good question, you know, Inigo. So if you ask me the question, I would say because it has high berry curvature. But then you can say, okay, but what would a chemist answer? A chemist would answer, okay, so you this volcano plot calculation people calculate the absorption of hydrogen on the surfaces, and they get the same results, more or less as we would get from the berry curvature. So they do different kind of calculations. So they would say the absorption and desorption of hydrogen molecules on a platinum surface is extremely efficient. So, So this is a chemistry answer, but the result is the same. Even the origin is totally different. But the question is more, this is more eventually a hand-waving argument, which is related. And then you can say maybe the absorption is related and relativistic effects play a role in the absorption and desorption of hydrogen on the platinum surface. Okay, good. Okay, why do I want to find a few words about magnetism? This is most of the time that I think it's interesting for people who make materials, because so in case of a magnetic white semi-metal, which is you break time reversal symmetry, so all crossings should be white points. And since you know everybody has seen already band structures, you know there's an inflation of band crossings in a band structure. So therefore, I still think there's is a lot of unexplored area and a lot of work to do. And it's only the limitation here is that I have not enough people to grow crystals and enough people, I have to do it partially. I have not enough time to scan everything for the whole databases, which I get to find even better magnetic materials. And also here, so this is an example, there are already a lot of materials out there where people predict interesting properties. So for example, the Heusler's cobalt manganese aluminium and cobalt manganese gallium. So we worked on this in the context of spintronics already a long time ago. It showed a giant anomalous Hall effect, this cobalt to manganese aluminium, there you can pay a patent out there related to the anomalous Hall effect. At this time, we didn't know really what is the origin. We already have known that this is a berry curvature effect, because in spintronics, people saw the anomalous Hall effect as additional contribution to the Hall effect in materials. This scales with the magnetization, because this was an observation until Nargosa published in and Visinova and others, and also Alan McDonald, that there is maybe a relation to the berry curvature. And nowadays, this is well established, and we can use calculation really for finding more interesting anomalous Hall effect eventually for Hall sensors. But the anomalous Hall effect is also via the Mott relation related to the anomalous Nernst effect. And the Nernst effect, the thermodynamic effect, is interesting for application. So also, if we have anomalous Hall, we have also anomalous Nernst. And there are more even antiferromagnetic materials. So if these properties would scale with the magnetization, their effect should be zero. But recently, due to topology and interesting, we learned also that we can find an antiferromagnetic giant anomalous Hall effect, and gadolinium platinum bismuth is another example. These are simply the crystals. And we look for sure also in this magnetic materials for what we look in the non-magnetic, for the chiral anomaly, the gravitational anomaly. We could look for experimental like light matter interaction I showed before, but here we can also look for quantum effects and 3D quantum effects, the quantum anomalous Hall effect and axion electrodynamics, what I already mentioned in the context of this manganese bismuth telluride. So there's, despite of APES and SDM, there's a whole slew of transport experiments which we can find in the magnetic system. More or less, this part here is a little bit missing in the chiral and the new fermion. So we have to still understand the response and transport of this new fermion. They're more metallic, but still I think we should think what we can see in new fermions. Anyway, in magnetic materials, you can find many interesting transport properties already. Maybe they're still to be seen. So I show only here the cobalt-3-tin-2-sulfide-2, a carbamic compound, and show a few properties as an example in the time which is still left. So this interesting compound is a half-metallic ferromagnet if you would not take spin orbit coupling into account, which means it has only electrons with one spin direction because it has a gap at the Fermi energy in the other spin direction. It's a very interesting compound because here the spins are out of plane, they are ferromagnetic, here's a cobalt layer, they are ferromagnetic. It's a quasi-2D material. Unfortunately, you cannot simply scotch tape it, otherwise I'm sure we would have found a fantastic quantum anomalous Hall effect. And it has a simple band structure, so there are two bands crossing at the Fermi energy. And if you apply spin orbit coupling, you get here at this Y point a small gap opening. So it's a quite simple band structure. And this compound, the Y points are very close to the Fermi energy. And the Y nodes are far from each other. So the Fermi arcs are quite large in this compound. And this compound is even related to a natural compound, so the shandite. So this is a class of material which you can even find in nature. So, and the first thing, and not the first thing, so what we did also here, measured this chiral anomaly to prove, do we see a chiral anomaly in this cobalt-3-tin-2-sulfide-2, which is our first sample. They were not super high mobility, so it was possible to measure the chiral anomaly without doubts. So then in collaboration with Julian here, we showed really this nice large Fermi arcs. This is a calculation and this is a measurement here in this compound. And since the Y points are slightly about the Fermi energy, so that we couldn't see them here in APES, so we have to dope the surfaces with potassium, and then you can see the Y points even here in APES in the bike electronic structure additional to the surface. Okay, so there was also a nice investigation of SDM by Heim's group. And so he investigated even different surfaces, the tin, the sulfide, and the cobalt surfaces. So what you saw is before the tin surface, which has this large Fermi arcs, and the cobalt surface, the Fermi arcs goes between different baryon zones, and the sulfide surface, unfortunately, there is no interaction with the cobalt. They are simply stuffing atoms, so therefore, they don't reflect the topology. So in general, one can do a toy model, and this was work from Noki and Jonathan and Jan Sun, who simply showed also, if you simply have a crossing point, Y points in a ferromagnet, you get, you apply spin orbit coupling, then you have a peak in the Berry curvature. This leads to an anomalous Hall effect. And as I said, due to the remote relation, also Nernst effect. And the Nernst effect is broader distributed in energy, which is maybe even more sensitive if you want to detect topological band structures. Sometimes it's not so easy to find the right points. And to show you this as an example, the Hall measurement in the cobalt-3-tin-2-sulfide-2, they show a nice square because this material shows out of plane magnetization, which means it's a hard magnet. And so this shows quite a high value. And there is a way to prove whether the Hall effect is really intrinsic relative to the Bell curve, which I already mentioned that there was a big change in thinking also in the Magnetic Society, in the Spintronic Society, so that you have an intrinsic range if you see a certain behavior as a function of the temperature. So we could show that the anomalous Hall effect in cobalt 3 tin 2, sulfate 2, but also in some other like manganese 3 tin, etc., behaves like is more intrinsic and not have extrinsic contribution like impurity scattering or screw scattering. So this is very interesting. So this was more for, so then even not only platinum has the highest Bray curvature as a non-magnetic paramagnetic metal. So nickel has also the highest Bray curvature as a magnetic material. So the prediction is here also quite large. It's like the Häusler compounds where the crossing is also exactly at the Fermi energy. And this is interesting. So far the experiment couldn't show this. So I think there's also still some space to understand why there's some disagreement, but it's also interesting. Anyway, so if we then look for the Nernst effect here in cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2, we find also very large Nernst effect. So this the compound shows a small canting here in the electronic structure. It seems to be the Nernst effect goes up to this temperature. So TC is a little bit higher here where it's very large. And then if you compare the Nernst effect versus the magnetization, so before it was believed it goes linear with the magnetization, you can understand because these are all old materials, these are conventional materials. But then if you see the topological materials like cobalt 2 manganese gallium and the cobalt 3 tin 2 sulfide 2 and the manganese 3 tin, so you see that their Nernst effect is much larger than what you expect from the conventional understanding, and this comes due to this giant enhancement based on the Bray curvature. Okay, so on the other side, it's interesting in this layered structure whether we can see quantum effects here. And for this reason, Sovietia started some investigation on the edges of the cobalt 3 tin 2 Häusler compound, and she thinks she sees evidence for 3D quantum anomalous Hall effect at the cobalt edge here in this compound as a function of exchange bias. And this is a little bit the understanding so that you can have in the extreme case that the white points would go to the end to the ends of the Bryant zone, so you would end up with magnetic topological insulator, and then you would see a quantum anomalous Hall effect here in this materials. Eventually you see it at the edges. So we still think there's a lot of space to think about how we understand this unusual behavior of non-magnetic white semi-metals and magnetic white semi-metals, and whether white semi-metals are a way maybe to find more 3D quantum effects even at higher temperature than what we see in this 2D electron system. So like also the tungsten telluride 2 in a monolayer shows, for example, an unexpected quantum spin Hall effect up to 100K. So there, I think, is still some questions open which have to be solved by the theory. Okay, so we think if we, for example, calculate the Hall conductivity per layer in a few of this material, the 2D material, it looks like it's not so far from one. This is also something which should be maybe is an interesting question to be solved by theory. Okay, this is maybe come slowly to the end. So this is some work which very nice work on this magnetic material. There's also a lot of prediction of new magnetic materials for us, a lot to do. And we already took a few of them and investigated them and found very interesting properties. But I hope that Maya soon will give us also more beyond the single particle picture, and we still get more nice materials to investigate. So I think I'm more or less at the end. I don't want to talk too much, but this is here my outlook, look, and it's again written in a proper way. Sorry for this increase of some of the writing on my slides. I hope it was not too much disturbing. So I still think, so what we know are, we know that we have now more than 25% are topological. If you take all the bands into account, maybe even more. So this is addressed to Adolfo. So we want to have more quantum simulators for high energy physics and astrophysics. And Adolfo, I can tell you, we are working on the horizon on the negative curvature of graphite. Anyway, and I think more chiral anomalies, etc., more nice, interesting prediction on Berry curvature effects, a lot of more. So we have now an expert in our group of light matter interaction. So anyway, he is also, it's maybe interesting for you, Adolfo. You know Fabian, right, from the other paper. So we might have even more possibilities to do crazy things beyond the proposal now from Jen Cano. And anyway, Maya works on the beyond single particle picture. Inigo, ready to go? And I am super excited about also with Johannes about the 3D quantum Hall effects, etc. And I'm super, 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 super excited about the chiral molecules, catalysis, and Berry curvature. Okay, good. And I hope you got a little bit of the excitement and you, as a young theoretician, thinking already about future things we can do as experimentalists. Thank you for your attention. So if there are more questions so far, there were nothing in the chat.
Thank you very much, Claudia. If there are any, we have time for a couple of questions, if no one has.
Maybe I make a comment on one thing that you said, Claudia, that cobalt silicon is a good material for this quantized circular photogalvanic effect. In fact, Lian Wu has an experiment already in measuring
this.
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah, yeah. So it's a good material, but it's not quite yet.
I think. Yeah, but I have the feeling we can improve it, you know, because
it would be nice.
I don't know whether it was a special crystal, but I think Maya knows. So Philip is doing some interesting quantum oscillation on this material. And it looks like that there are not so many bands, you know, there is less bands, so it's less crowded. So I thought we should check whether it's maybe depends on the question.
Yeah, it would be really nice to have a Carol Vassini metal like that that's clean.
I simply want to say there's hope. Sorry.
Yeah, that's my question. Like whether you have a perspective of having like a chiral vial in the middle where the vials are really nicely separated, is that possible? Why is that so hard?
I think you're right. So one is the band structure, but in Kubert Sidis side, I have to really look careful, but I think the measurement from Philip is like showing it has not so we have to do more quantum oscillation on all the crystals and look for the very, very, very best crystals. So because there can be intrinsic doping and we can dope them, you know, we might have to do more doping to remove a few bands. Because iron silicide, for example, is a trivial insulator. So which means this is a very good starting point to start with the insulator, right?
Right.
Because this tells us already we can have no bands in the gap. Okay, and now we could try to design the band structure. You're right, we should work harder on this.
Are you already working very hard? Thanks.
Well, okay, if there are no more questions or comments, thank you, Claudia, again to join us one more year. Hopefully we can come with you next year in person and
eat baby pork.
I come whether you invite me or not.
I think at this point you don't need an invitation. So, all right.
I belong to the family.
Very much. So, okay. Thank you again and good afternoon, morning. evening, everybody, and see you tomorrow at the same time.